Science Laboratory in 2010. He completed his MSc and MPhil in physics from CUSAT. A hearty welcome, sir. I would also like to cordially welcome Srimati Annamma John, Dr. Jayesh K. Joseph, Dr. G.B. Arvind, Shri Abdul Razak, officers from FSL of Kerala, Tamil Nadu and other states, officers from CFSL, other senior officers from Crime Branch of Kerala and other states, Mr. Venkateshan and TBLAB Systems, Mumbai, ICFSA members and all participants attending this webinar session. I now hand over the session to the presiding expert, Shri Sanoj M.A.
Okay, thank you, Sheda. Good morning and welcome all participants to the 14th session of this ICFSA webinar series. As a presenting officer, I just want to introduce the speaker of this particular session. And we all know the transformation through technology in the field of forensic sciences in the need of the time. The lab systems is the pioneer in the digital forensics in India. They have a very good professionals, engineering professionals to commit forensic solutions, and they are assisting so many clients in various industries, and they assist so many investigations in the field of forensic science, and they also provide so many softwares, and they are the one of the leading company as a part of the distributors in India. They are mainly working as a distributors of the forensic software such as NCASE, FTK and FastBlock, and so many digital forensics analysis softwares. And here we have Mr. Vinay Vishwanath, who is the Associate Vice President of Lab Systems, Mumbai. He is working in this company from 2016 onwards. And his area of interest is he's working as a consultant in fraud investigation projects and lab implementation, along with the project planning and implementation of client interactions and all. And especially they're working in data recovery of the lost data and digital forensics analysis and training. So I wish to welcome Mr. Vinay Vishwanath to conduct this seminar or a particular talk on the enhancing and analyzing of video evidences. As we all know, the video evidence is very crucial evidence in digital forensics, because in every cases we have a CCTV footage or either a camera footage, such things. So in many of these CCTV footages are not available very clearly. So in order to make it clear and bring it to the before the court of law, we have to enhance or modify these things. So what all things we can do to enhance the video evidences, and all these things will be, I think all these things will be covered by this eminent speaker. And I heartily welcome Mr. Vinay Vishwanath to conduct this speech on enhancing and analyzing of video evidences. Mr. Vinay Vishwanath, please start your session, and you have a very warm welcome to this particular series of webinar.
Thank you so much, Sanoj sir, for the fantastic introduction. I could not have introduced myself and the company better. Thank you so much, the entire team, the organizing committee, for organizing this webinar. And I believe, as forensic experts, spending a Sunday in front of a laptop or a mobile phone instead of spending time with the family, this shows our commitment towards our passion and what we would like to do in the area of forensics. I believe that says all. So let me give you a quick background of what I do, and what a quick brief about lab systems as well. So I will try to keep it very short. There is a quick presentation in which we will try to understand a bit of evolution, a bit of theory, but a lot of things we would really like to show you. How do you actually enhance and analyze using various tools? So quickly, I'm trying to share my screen. If anyone could allow me to share my screen, please. Cool. So just hide my video for some time. Great. The idea is to spend and utilize the next 90 minutes to understand how we can utilize video evidences in a better way. As far as our story of Lab Systems is considered, we have been in the market since 1989. Venkatesan sir, my mentor, started this as a part of his mission to solve crime efficiently and within a stipulated period of time. Then that has given us opportunity to analyze hard disk, mobile devices and various kind of digital evidences. In the last few years, we have seen a dramatic evolution of need of video forensic and video investigation tools. And that has led to our exploration and our study in this area. I have been part of Lab Systems, like Sanoj sir mentioned, since 2016. And my core responsibility is video forensics and video investigations. Prior to this, I have been part of Ernst & Young, HCL and other companies. But, video forensics and investigation has always been close to my heart because it involves a lot of mathematics around it. Basically, why do we need something like a video forensics? So any kind of crime scene, whenever you have or any kind of cases you see, there are majorly two people who generally, interact in the cases. The first is the first responder. He's the person who's going at the crime scene, whose major responsibility is to have. The task of the first responder is more towards getting some actionable intelligence, utilizing it to solve the crime then and there itself. As well as, while it is being done that, the evidences should not be tampered. You should be able to process a lot of video in very short amount of time. So that is the need of the first responder. The second kind of users which law enforcement agencies generally look at is the power users. So once the first responder is, has performed the task and is unable to have some conclusive intelligence, that is when the power user comes into place, not always. I believe there are a few people commenting on the chat that the PPT is not visible to them. I request you, ladies and gentlemen, to just pin it. You will have to scroll through my name, look at the screen and just pin it. So in terms of the power users, these are users, let us consider them in an Indian scenario, this might be people who are in the forensic science laboratories. So whenever a case does not get resolved at the end of the police, there is some kind of, more expert opinion required than the power user comes into place. The major requirement of the power users is video enhancement, video manipulation check, image editing check, and the ability to process large amount of videos. So that is the requirement of power users. So what kind of task means, I'm sure everyone is from the forensic background, so this would all sound very similar and a day-to-day activity for you guys. So just to iterate, you need a forensic replica. You need a forensic replica, you do a 1-to-2 imaging or 1-to-1 imaging, you have the necessary E01 DD files in whichever you want. You will connect it, through a write block and perform deleted data recovery using various set of tools. You can identify events, report chain of events. So the major task here is, if you see, that is actionable intelligence and...
Yes, Vinay, carry on. Participants, please pin the screen to your system, so you will be seeing only the screen in the coming hours. Okay.
Yes, because there are two Vinay Vishwanath that will be seen on the screen. There will be, because we are sharing it from another laptop. So please click on the screen where you can see the generic task and the PowerPoint written. So that is the right kind of a screen to be pinned. So moving on, in understanding, so we have understood that the first responder is really trying to perform task reports and everything, whereas the power user is more interested in using more number of, so the first responder also will have some basic clarification that he wants to perform, because again the first responder might not be well versed in the mathematics behind. I believe Mr. Amol has started presenting again. I'm sorry for this inconvenience, everyone. If you see, the task performed by power users are to enhance video to check missing frames, if there are cloned frames, and various other visual inspection to understand tampering or not. So that kind of task, when it is to be performed, so generally everyone asks us, what is the recommendation that comes from lab systems? How do we, more or less whenever I meet anyone from the law enforcement, they say, Vinay, what do you recommend? How do we take care of all these scenarios? So the kind of recommendation we do is something like a end-to-end video investigation console. If you see, this is like a desk which has ability to have all the tools mentioned below. I will touch base on the tools, just an overview, not a hands-on on each of them. The first major part is whenever a video evidence comes to your lab, audio video lab or the video forensic lab, the investigation that we are talking about, the main part is to have an end-to-end workflow and directly to give an automated report and analytics to the assistant director or the directors to understand how many cases have come inside my video lab, what are the size of files that we have been working on, what are the types of cases we have been working on, are we working on authentication cases, and like what kind of cases. So all that information, which we call as the digital evidence manager, this is a tool from Kinesense which integrates and sits on top of this entire infrastructure, which allows you to manage your video forensic lab very efficiently. Kinesense LE allows you to perform a simple set of clarifications. It allows you to process very large amount of CCTV footages. It is very useful in that sense. We have Impress, which allows us to enhance and use a variety of filters. We will have a hands-on session on Impress going forward. Then we have Mandate, which allows us to do authentication of images as well as video. Mind you, I believe Mandate is the only tool which can do video authentication. Then we have Ipsotech, which allows us to perform large amount of video investigation in a connected environment. So something like smart city, safe city projects, all this Ipsotech is going to be very critical. And I believe DVR Examiner needs no introduction in the world of forensics. It is the best tool, I believe, to recover deleted data recovery or get files from E01 and DD file formats. Industry standard, non-Chinese product, works very well. So this is the kind of solution that we suggest. Coming to the main agenda of this webinar, and what we are going to focus in the coming time is enhancement and analysis. How do we utilize tools to perform these two tasks? Enhancement, let us understand, enhancement will be always on low amount of data. You already know what is to be enhanced. You know where the person is or what has to be enhanced. So that is the main task in this process. Analysis is majorly involvement of in terms of two major things. One is processing of large volume of data, which is, we have multiple DVRs, NVRs coming in. So if we do not have the ability to process large volumes of data, that can be a hindrance towards our investigation. That is one. The second is in terms of analysis is a subpart, which can be authenticity. Authenticity of an image, authenticity of a video. So how do we do these two tasks? The first is Impress Pro. Quickly, a very old company since 1991, a few years later after Lab Systems was established. It has a fantastic Q&A feature, which I really like. large number of feature sets, fantastic file format support, and it has been winning the best super resolution challenge in the European National Forensic Science something. So that is a challenge, and they have been winning it for a long time. So we will see a hands-on on various type of enhancement that has been required into a day-to-day life. So we are trying is to share our knowledge with the community, what our team has been doing in terms of cases and supporting to our customers and what we have found out. So we will see a few types of motion blurs. We will also then look at video and image authentication with respect to specific manipulation detectors. How do we understand what kind of image is manipulated and what is not? I do not want to take a lot of time on the slides, so I will just quickly go ahead. This is the tool from Ipsotech, this is the future of video investigations. Video will be investigated going forward in a connected environment where there are multiple CCTV cameras. The idea for the law enforcement is to have immediate intelligence. So this is a quick video of the system that we have taken. So example, there has been an incident somewhere related to this particular car in your current infrastructure, which might be, in this case, is near an airport or a location. You select the particular incident. You're looking at what kind of incident you want to, analyze. You are looking at, okay, this is the guy that I'm looking at. He has taken his phone and he's moved away from the camera after parking the vehicle. So as soon as you see, you have an abandoned vehicle. The PTZ camera here is a smart PTZ camera, which is configured by Ipsotech, and it can go in and take the necessary details after there has been an event. Sorry. So there is an abandoned vehicle. You have the event is here. You have zoomed it. You click on the event and you create a investigation case. So if you see here, parallelly, you have created a new tab of investigation. Now you are clicking on a single button here, which is track, and automatically the AI algorithm of Ipsotech allows you to identify and track people. You quickly move and perform a forensic search on top of it, because the main part of searching videos is interconnectivity. So I want to be able to search number plates. I want to be able to search faces. I want to be able to connect multiple things. So if you see, I have two places where there is number plates are being seen, and I have connected to those areas. So as soon as I create a new forensic search. Now I'm not looking for number plates. I'm looking for faces. And for faces, if you see, I have created a radius around a particular location of what faces I want to search in cameras. As soon as I zoom it, I have been identified that there are a few faces that have been identified around it. I will create a selection again of most nearby faces. As soon as again I create that, I have identified a particular face. And once I again take that face and create a search on top of the face, an investigation, I have been able to track it around the location that is where I had found my initial car. So if you see, the initial car was found here, the face was found here. So we are able to interlink these two data and provide fantastic intelligence for investigation. So that is how we believe a lot of smart cities and safe cities going forward will perform investigation. Railways and all those organizations will utilize such kind of infrastructures. What is this infrastructure about? What is this infrastructure about? How does this work? So for law enforcement, for forensic people, what we majorly focus on is these two areas, forensics and investigation. Forensic search is the ability to search anything. You can, example, in a forensic science laboratory, you have, you know, one entire for hard disk coming in for 30 days, and you want to identify a particular phase in it. You want to identify an object in it. You want to identify a few AI parameters, or you want to perform AI calculations on it. So that kind of forensic search can be done using Ipsotek's platform. The Ipsotek VI investigation is a multi-camera tracking. If you like seen in the video, if you want to connect two or more cameras, in that scenario, multi-camera tag and track will be very useful. And all this intelligence is sitting on various AI suites, which is based on artificial intelligence, license plate recognition, and facial recognition. So just an overview of how the future investigation looks like. I believe I'm done with the presentation. I will not take more time in the presentation right now and move on to the hands-on of what we want to see is Impress Pro for enhancement and mandate for authentication. Okay. So this is the user interface that pops in once you open your Impress Pro. Right now, I'm currently using Impress 7. Impress 8 has been launched a few weeks back, which is much more advanced. It works on GPU and utilizes the CUDA cores for optimum performances. Right now, in this particular version, I do not have any kind of GPU or accelerators on this. So we will try to look at the normal algorithms, not the GPU algorithms. So firstly, having an overview of this interface, we call this the film straight or the recent tabline, where you have all your cases that you were working on recently. This place, the original that has been seen here, the left side, here you have a series where you can put in all your transformation that is required, during your case. And you have multiple other inputs on this as well. And here in the right pane, you will see the case. So let me just click on this particular case. Zoom this out. Great. So you have a lot of controls here in the bottom. You can play around with the timeline here, the frame rate, what is the frame count here. There's a few part of the screen which is not being seen, but this is a very well established video forensic tool. So, video to frame conversion, exporting it out, exporting in various formats, that has all been very much taken care of. In terms of the menu options on the top, so what do we have in menu options? The first part in terms of is the ability to take any format or any type of videos. That is where the main forensic tools have been utilized. So you can import image, video. You can import an entire, set of still images and import it as a video. You can do a desktop capture. You can do a live capture for IP cameras, analog cameras, and you have various connecting options as well in terms of if it is an analog cameras, you use multiplexing and demultiplexing that happens on analog cameras because of digital sampling. So you can take care of that. And you have a pipeline, which is very customer centric, where we use and, create specific macros if the user is unable to perform any particular task. So this is how the support function works. If there's anything that cannot be done, there is a specific macro that is written for the customer, and that if it can be taken care of, that has been taken care of. Then we have, we will see these four options in some time. We will move to something like tools and help menu first. In the tools, as soon as, example, you have imported the video, you have taken a video or you have taken an image, and you want to now export the video in a specific format, you do not want to process it, so you directly want to export, you can do that. You can convert it, you can extract an audio, you can merge multiple audios onto this. You can compare, the files. This is just a side-by-side comparison for visual understanding. You can look at location data, metadata. Location data is nothing but your EXIF data, which is into a visual format. You can print in the reporting facilities, PDF, XPS, export is possible. The main part that comes and what I really like about in terms of Impress is the Q&A feature, because video forensic, every case is unique. We at Lab Systems on a single enhancement spend continuously about 7 to 8 hours at least. Sometimes if it's a critical case, it is going to go on for days and days. That is why you have a design which allows you to stand and sit, the Labster design that we saw earlier, the desk kind of scenario. So you can lift up the entire desk, stand up and work for a few hours. You can sit down and work for a few hours as well. So in the Q&A section, when we start in, my major challenge is there are a lot of comments in the chat section. I hope everyone is able to see, and if they're not, please pin. Okay, so first is, what is the footage? So I can clearly answer that I'm currently working on a video. Then as soon as I select options, if you see out of this zillion algorithms, I believe, if you see, these are algorithms, mathematical algorithms, which I believe if there's an engineering student, he might have implemented this inside a MATLAB as part of image processing, interpolation and other techniques. But these are nothing but mathematical algorithms programmatically written so that we as forensic experts can directly utilize it by understanding the concept and not the mathematical calculation behind it. So the next question is, how do you want to enhance? For example, I do not know anything. Example, I have jerky lines on my video. It's an analog video example. So I will select this option. It will say, okay, it's an analog video. It has jerky lines. So the most probable answer for this is the interlacing technique. So we have a few techniques of de-interlacing and a few things. So we can utilize that. And a lot of other things. If you want to process a number plate, there is a specific algorithm for plate. Currently, India, so this plates, if you see, these are standard plates in various European, British and other countries. In the Impress 8 version, we have the entire user interface that you see is available in Hindi. Sooner, it will be available in Tamil, Malayalam and all regional languages of the Indian regional languages, so that there is no hindrance in learning the science behind all this. And the number plate also, right now we do not have a support for Indian number plates, but sooner or later in the coming version, in the coming months, we will have support for Indian number plates as well. So the idea of this particular task is that I can be doing a lot of things just by answering a few questions. And every time I answer the question, it will keep on changing the algorithms that it suggests. And this is a good starting point for anyone who is starting their work in video forensics. We do not generally know ki screen mein kya hua hai. We have a few understanding of what is happening in the screen, which I will take you through in the next few moments. But there is a vagueness when we start an investigation. So this question and answers really allows us to understand that what is the starting point. So example, we have something like an integrate. We will come back to this particular option again. I want to touch base on a few slides on basics of images and a few things for everyone such that we get on the same page when we are talking here. So the another option that I really like is once I click on any kind of these algorithms, complex 140 algorithms, I know when should I be using it. There is a specific use cases for specific algorithms. So we clearly understand when to use it. We clearly understand the advantages. In what scenario this is going to be advantageous for us as forensic experts. Sorry, forensic people. I don't know. Disadvantages, there are every algorithm is written by a human being. There will be some or the other disadvantages. And we need to find out alternatives and work around this. And there is the science behind it. Why does this work? And the necessary parameters, once you click on this, you will have a few set of parameters which you have to tweak to get the desired results. So that kind of information has been given. And all these is references by white papers written by PhD students on everyone. And some of the other references can be found out. So there is references also available. And if you see, there are multiple tags on the right hand side bottom where you can look at what all. If you see at the tags, you will really understand what Folklore as a company thinks that this can be used in. So this can be used in noise, compression, block, and a lot of things. Similarly, let me go back here. I have a very clear-cut option. So again, people come to me, say, how do I start this? How do I work on video? How do I start gaining knowledge on top of this? So there is a clear-cut understanding of how to video, how to the option. You have a series of tasks which we generally perform. You want to apply a filter, you want to apply a super resolution, character match, convert, crop, delog, deinterlace. So we had seen the option of deinterlacing, which the Q&A option had suggested us when we tried to work on jerky lines. So if you click on deinterlace, it will open the help menu, very specific to Impress, and it will show you an entirely dedicated guide and understanding of how you utilize Impress Pro in various steps to understand and perform deinterlacing. So this is, again, when we started off, this was a fantastic starting point of us when we wanted to perform a few tasks. Once you have understood, I believe, these set of tasks, you move on to something like creating very specific keyboard shortcuts, which allows you to save in time. End of the day, we use tools and techniques to save in a lot of time. So we can use this. And there are a few understanding of symbols that you see across Impress Pro. We are looking at customizing these symbols to very much pertaining to the Indian audience and helping them understand what symbols makes us realize this very easily. Just like any other forensic tool, it has a series of audit trail. You see whatever we have tasked, we have performed, it has a task. We can display the log level information, export it, and all this. We have the necessary settings in terms of video, requires a lot of settings for various kind of videos to be played across codec. So we can perform those settings here. Locations where you want to save in and files, that be here. So this is the licensing part of the software. And resources in terms of keyboard that we already see. Display, again, like you have seen in the presentation, we have, if you have a single monitor currently, it is fantastic, great. But for video forensics, we generally suggest a dual display monitor. We currently at Lab Systems do use it, a dual display monitor at our lab in Navi Mumbai. But currently I'm using my laptop, so hence it is single display. So this was in terms of the entire user's interface and what all really you can do with Impress Pro, the 7th version. Sorry, I did not cover what all you can do. So if you see, this is the section of filters. various set of algorithms divided into four major sections. The first is the input, the second is the selection, the third is the filter, and fourth is the output. The name itself is very self-explanatory. So this is our first task, input. So in input, you are able to do a source control, pre-processing, any kind of transformation that is required at the time of inputting the video or taking the video in inside your system. This is so whenever you take the, this would be very useful whenever you take lines from analog cameras. Old manufacturing industries really have analog thermal cameras everywhere. So if you really want that kind of videos to be right away processed while the input has been taken, so you would be performing this. There is a certain task that has to be performed at the selection level as well. Demuxing of inputs is the major task that we perform in analog cameras. Redub X, redint, and Mansell can be manual selection can be done when you understand, I believe, the science behind it and how exactly the interlacing has happened. We will come back to the science on the presentation in a few minutes. This will make sense by the end of this session. You have a tracking ability to track objects. Tracking, the word is a bit, might not be the right word for the self-explanatory tab, but the main part that comes in is stabilization. If you have a video coming in from a bridge which is near the toll, generally near the tolls, there are cameras on the bridge. So if you see, if a vehicle has been moving, if a very heavy vehicle on a narrow bridge is moving, it might shake at times. So that kind of shaking will happen and that shaking can be taken care of by stabilization. So we are looking at stabilization of optical stabilization. The entire camera is shaky. So in that kind of case, stabilization is really helpful. You have drop stabilization, which also allows you to transform it during stabilization. Masking, highlighting, all this is for majorly if you have a press release that has to be done and you want to mask out the person who a criminal or a person who is a victim, that can be done. Highlighting can be done of the criminal. Masking can be done for the victim. Similarly, we have, this is where we at Lab Systems spend the maximum amount of time, is these two major algorithms, integration and super resolution. We will see in-depth understanding of this integration and super resolution going forward in the examples. Integration, like the name or the mathematical term, integration and differentiation. Integration will always overlap frames on frames. It has multiple other names as well. You can in various tools you call it with different names. I'm not able to recollect a few names right now, but more or less it is just saying that we are going to integrate all the frames together and perform a signal to noise ratio and give you better analytics. Super resolution is nothing but a proprietary algorithm. Majorly, every company has their own super resolution algorithm. It's a proprietary algorithm. The best company wins, to be honest. That kind of super resolution is very much proprietary to every company. This is all performed at the selection level, at the time where I'm still trying to figure out whether I can see or whether I cannot see. But once I can see and I can move on to that, I will move to the area of filters. So the Q&A filters will always suggest what kind of filters do I require. So there is a wide variety of filters present in Impress Pro. While there are a lot of filters, honestly speaking, there are a lot of filters. The more you understand, the more you know, the more time you are going to spend in solving a case. We started off saying that, you know, investigations and enhancement takes 1 or 2 hours to do. Right now, we have, you know, multiple other algorithms that we have gained knowledge of. And we now believe that it is going to take 6-7 hours at least to come up with a case that does not get solved. There are cases that get solved by a few set of tricks that we have learned, which we will be sharing in the next 30 minutes. But yes, more or less, it is an R&D duration. So across this, you see noise. If you have noise in your, image or video, that is the kind of things that you are looking at. The major algorithms that we look at are the noise algorithms, which is denoise, which we as at Lab Systems use. If we have a GPU accelerator, if we use it at our workstation in our lab, not in my laptop, we would always use GPU denoise. It is utilization of CUDA cores. Yes, it is an hardware accelerator. It will give better results. What this results is given by this algorithm will not be given by this algorithm. While we thought initially that it is just a performance improvement, we have in the Impress 8 version, we have seen that it is not just a performance improvement. It is also a quality improvement in terms of visual quality. Similarly, we have contour algorithms, sharpening algorithms, deblur, all this terminology, I believe, very well explained on Wikipedia. No rocket science, one single Google search can really enable us. And all this algorithm, how they work, is very well mentioned in the FAQ section as well as the help menu of Impress. Majorly to do with luminosity transformations you have here. Basic set, I believe all this can be today be done in a mobile phone editing software. No rocket science here. Whatever you're doing on a Snapseed or a mobile editing, image editing, all this is present here. Gamma is something which mobile phone do not allow. If you have a paid real good Photoshop version of knowing on your mobile phone, you could really do the gamma as well. So this section of filters deals with light, contrast and all other things. Resamplers very rarely use because it is the resampling technique used and the super resolution technique used are more or less same, but we have personally found out super resolution to be better. But in a few scenarios, if you already have a super high resolution image, creating a super high resolution image or of a high resolution image becomes a bit challenging. So in such scenarios, you might use scaling. In scenarios where you do not want to look at information and identify more information, but you really want to understand just display it rightfully, then you will use scaling approximation. Flipping, rotation, all this scaling, these few parts generally is not used in the forensic science laboratories, I believe. Yes, there are shift frames, subpixel information that can be seen out, number plate, character information, barrel connection, all this has been generally being used. This becomes a heart of utilization in lot of countries. Right now, we do not have a support for Hindi, Marathi, Tamil, other languages. But sooner, at Lab Systems, we are absolutely committed in revolutionizing this space. So you will see some of the other Hindi, Marathi. Initially, Hindi will come in, and then the regional languages will also come in. And the last part of the set of algorithms that is there in Impress Pro is the output parameters. Display, overlays, these are just nothing telling you, let us just output this. Let us make sense out of all that we have done. You can have watermark, you can have measurement done, you can have annotation done. This is all for output feature. Measurement is to make someone else understand. Annotation is to make someone else understand. Watermark is to prevent your copyright information. If we are working on a case, we really want to put our watermark of lab system that this is a case that we have produced, if it is something that we do example. So that kind of things can be done. You also have a targeted option. You can print this particular image report. You can have multiple ways to output this. You can still image, you can create an album, you can create a poster, and left and right things for the law enforcement. So this becomes the entire gambit and features that Impress Pro provides. Once we share this tool with everything and people come up with, okay, this is good, but how do I start understanding more about this? How do I get into the science about this? So we have a 3-day training program. I will try to sum it up in the next 15 minutes and try to make more sense out of this and try to get into the science, what we try to emphasize at Lab Systems, because science is everything, I believe. So this is the curriculum that we generally take. Image is nothing but a binary representation of everything that we see, ones and zeros. Forensic experts already in this group know that all information gets saved in ones and zeros. Image is no different. This is nothing but the evolution of the image first taken, and the first color photograph has been taken in 1861. After that, there have been quantum level of evolutions in terms of photography and digital photography that we have seen. Majorly for us in the forensic world, we see two kind of images in general. Images can be categorized in two major formats. One is the vector, another is the raster or the bitmap. As the vector name itself suggests, in the world of mathematical, it is something which has direction and shape. It is geometrical representation. Whereas raster is what we generally get in our investigation, which is generally nothing but array of pixel. When we say array of pixel and a geometric representation, this is a clear understanding of that. So if this particular image is being saved as a vector and is a font example, a Photoshop file, a CorelDRAW file, any kind of open file format that we see, which has font information in them, they are nothing but vectors. And we have bitmaps, which have, box information. Each of this bitmap, if you see, this is a smiley. Each of this bitmap is being having as a pixel value. As you see, this is the 3 pixel. If you zoom out, zoom in any kind of image like this image, if you zoom in, you will see this. And eventually when you zoom in, you will see this information. Each and every information has R, G, B value, or it has some C, Y, M, K value. So, RGB value are the prominence of everything that we do. So I will just quickly open my calculator. So the range is 256 bit, which is 255 to 255. So when I do 255 of R, which is red, inside a pixel, into 255 of green, which is inside a pixel, into 255 of B, which is inside pixel, I get something called as this number. Hence, we say that there is 16 million colors that you can see on a particular screen because it is able to render the RGB value. With the increase in technology, we have seen that LED technology has come up, and there has been a coefficient for transparency, which is again from 255 to 255, sorry, 0 to 255. So if I had 255 to it, if you see, now I have what I call the 4K resolution on the screen. So this is the general mathematics or the science behind it. So the 4K resolution that we see. Going back to our presentation, compression, forensics compression is a challenge. People come up to us and say that, you know, there is this WhatsApp image and can you enhance it? So WhatsApp image, whenever it is sent through multiple compression techniques and it is very difficult to manage. There are multiple compression techniques and we have some kind of, you know, file formats which help us, something like the TIFF. So we suggest that all files that are being exported from Impress or any tool should be in this particular file format because it's a lossless compression and it is a guaranteed 24-bit information and generally used by professional photographers. We are not able to export in raw file format with this. We see a lot of file formats in images. Generally, we see JPEG, PNG and TIFF coming into us a lot. In terms of videos, it is nothing but a sequence of images where individual pictures are put into sequence to create an illusion for us. It is illusion because when 8 to 10 images are put per second, they create an illusion. If you have anything less than that, it might really give some jerks while viewing the video. You have various, all these images are called as frames. In frames, you have something called as keyframes, which is very utilized in terms of authentication process of videos to understand this. Then there is frame rate. Frame rate has an impact on forensics, stating that if it is a fast moving object, more the frames per second, better we can view it in slow motion, better the enhancement, and we have a lot of options to play with if we have high frames per second in a fast moving object. If a fast moving object has low frames per second, it is challenging. We see in a lot of cameras, they perform something called as frame averaging technique. This is not something rocket science, but this nothing but signal to noise ratio. Whatever is changing in my video, let that information be kept and retained again and again. But whatever is constant, let that information be there. Every camera manufacturer codec has different methods of doing frame averaging. Okay, this is one of the major concepts for enhancement of images, which we call as the interpolation technique. Interpolation, as the definition says, is nothing but a process of estimating the unknown values. There are a few values between this pixel. So whenever we want to add in enhance image or super resolute image, what we are doing is in the background, we are mathematically calculating what is going to be the probable R, G, B value of the pixel, and we are going to put that value inside that whatever is the desired pixel. Hence, a 100 by 100 image gets into a 1000 by 1000 image because the tool is calculating using algorithms to find unknown values that fall between the known values. Because as you have seen in the earlier screen of the smiley, we really, if we go to pixel level, we know what is the RGB value. So what we do is we create mathematically in the background interpolation or bicubic. There are multiple type of interpolation. I'm not getting into deep diving into what it is, the mathematics of it, but just to give an overview, consider this to be functions being created. Example, f of 0, f of 1, f of 2, f of 3. And you have to put, pixel values between them. You will always calculate a function. And this interpolation technique in this particular example is to compress an image. The same technique can be used to enhance an image. So the mathematical formula is the same. You put it from left, you process it from left to right, you can enhance an image. You process it from right to left, you can compress an image as well. Okay, so this is the best way to put it forward of how do we see enhancement or super resolution, the science behind it. So this is the original image. I have enlarged it 183%. So if you see, these question marks are the unknowns that we are trying to calculate using the super resolution algorithm example or the scaling algorithm, whatever interpolation technique proprietary it uses in the background, we are able to create the after interpolation. So this is the thing that we are interested in. So this is something we are going to get. This is something that we are going to do. And if we do not do that, we have the same information. So that is of no use. So that is why we use various interpolation techniques for image enhancement. Camera resolution important. Better the camera resolution, better you see. More the zoom, less you see. More if the zoom, if you have taken an image in 8x, that is the time you see less pixel values and other things. Aspect ratio for forensics, I believe the only thing that we have to remember is we should not change the aspect ratio. We should work on, unless and until we want to transform, we can drop it, with some algorithms, but aspect ratio should not be touched and should be understood very well while we work on it. The major understanding which I believe we are trying to convey to a lot of video forensic people is to understand the focal length of whatever video you are working on. The focal length is nothing but the distance between the lens and the image sensor. This gives us a better example. So imagine, there's something concept called as aperture. Aperture is nothing but, imagine this to be blinking of your eyelid. The more eyelid you open, the more information you will get to see, but the more light will fall onto your eyes as well. That's why early morning when you are able get out of the house and you look at the sun, you might not able to open your entire eye. So that is example. That would be a vague example of something like an aperture. So this is the opening of the eye. Then the image sensor and the lens has some distance. That is the focal length. And depending upon my focal length and aperture, that is a calculation which allows me to have a field of view. So from, this is my field of view. For this particular aperture and this particular focal length, this is my field of view. So anything, this area or this area for each camera is called as the blind spot. And this particular line, if you see this line and this line is nothing but the distance in which you have a calculation for focal length in terms of what kind of pixel information will be seen very clearly. So that kind of information, this is the distance of the field of view, that in which a clearly an object will be seen. So anything in this particular area, example, or outside the calculation of a focal length and the angle of view. And if it is missing out the angle of view, it is a blind spot. We cannot do anything of it. But if it is, beyond the focal length, because you will, position of the camera might be such that the object might be away from the focal length yet be seen in the camera. So that kind of object. So this kind of object, if you see, if in this camera, the focal length efficiency has stopped here, but it can still see this particular distance till the time it heads for a block. So that kind of images can be worked on by using de-blurring algorithms. We use a de-blurring algorithms for anything. We call it, this phenomena is called as misfocus generally, because it is beyond the focal length. Compression techniques in video are lossy and lossless, generally done with the help of codec, which is coder and decoder. If you see the bottom, lossy compression will always impact quality. So generally when you are exporting it from a DVR side and everything, please do not change the native file format. Whenever we are changing the native file format, or if we are changing the codec that we use, 90% of the time we do not know what codec has been used to change the file format. So that will always impact the quality. The lossless impression when you are using the same codec, same file format and transforming the video, that is when lossless compression happens. And that is the best part for us to be used or exported. Various file formats to be seen, 264, H264, everything. All of this has been supported on, I believe, Impress Pro, Kinescence, DVR Examiner. All these tools support all the file formats. The bottom line remains what impacts the quality of video, frame rate, resolution, focal length, aperture, the zooming and the compression codec used. Quickly, going forward to the CCTV, I do not want to get into the science and the what all CCTV is present. Just a quick example, this is how a DVR system looks like. You have a hard disk in place. Nowadays, we have found out that you have independent camera on crime scenes as well. People who do in a lot of cash transactions and a lot of things have independent cameras. They want to keep all the information inside an SD card and not anywhere in the network. And whenever there is a raid or anything happening, they will just remove the SD card and break it. So please, whenever we are going to the crime scene, this is something that we suggest the law enforcement to look at as well. Various components, various digital sampling process and interlacing. So the technique of interlacing that we had seen, it might not be applicable in 99% of the times because we deal with digital videos. We do not deal with analog system. This is specifically for analog system. So if you see or remember the old days of television, you use lines because there was field one and field two, which was digitally sampled. So the curve waves here were converted into digital samples and you had multiple fields. For the example, we have kept this, but you have multiple fields, whatever is type you're interlacing and you're processing the analog video, and then you get the frame. So whenever you understand that you have a video feed coming in from an analog system, interlacing is a mandatory process. Camera sensitivity. Angle, yes, this is also important, I believe. Yes, I would really not get into this calculation of all the tan inverse and all how this gets calculated. I want to emphasize on the point stating that. So you see, this is the camera angle. So if you see, if I draw something which is very in the line, it would be something like this. So imagine the focal length has stopped somewhere here. This is the range of camera. Bichara camera itna hi perform kar sakta hai. But the object is here, which is still in the field of view. This is the camera is allowing the object to be seen, but the autofocus of the camera, depending upon the focal length, is only able to see object between this. So if a person is standing here, then it will be able to see it very clearly. You do not require forensics, anything. It will work fantastically. The law enforcement can work on top of it. But if you have anything that goes beyond, you really need to understand how to process it and how to work around it. So this is the impact of quality of video coming from CCTV. If you see, this is the only addition which has happened with respect to CCTV. The angle also impacts understanding the angle. Understanding the limitations of the angle is very important, because while we can do mathematically, we can play with misfocus and a lot of things. Angle is a physical phenomena, which we sitting at around our laptop, managing it right now, we do not have a major knowledge about it, but I'm sure going forward, some great scientists will work around it as well. This is the one of the things that I want to take you through in the first phase. An understanding of what input images look like, what are channels and what results are. So in the left hand side, if you look at, that is an input image which is blurred. I do not know the reason of blur at this stage. This can be a blur because of a camera moving. This can be a blur because of the object being away from the camera too much. This can be because of the camera moving from autofocus to manual focus and creating the blur. This can be a blur just because I am a bad cameraman. I could have shaken the camera while taking the video. Whenever we have color objects, whenever we have skin tone and everything, it has a lot of pink and red shades in it. So we generally view it. Any kind of tones have to be moved into the red channel. This is a suggestion. You can move it in 10 other channels and then you get the desired results. I will go back to my Discord. I'll go back to my Impress Pro. In the interest of time, I believe we are already at 12:40. I have authentication also to cover. So I will quickly help you understand how a few algorithms work and very quickly. So imagine this to be a regular case. A car moving in, coming to near a signal. It might have performed theft and coming back and it is still standing there. I cannot view this particular image, unfortunately, because of the headlight of the camera directly facing somewhere at the lens. It might not be directly facing, but it is hitting the top view of the camera. So what I would do is I will come back. So now I understand that I have a few set of static frames and I want to remove the noise around the number plate and I want to focus on the numerics that are available on the number plate. So I will select the perfect region for it. So if you see in the bottom, I have selected only the place where the car is static and being present, because this is the algorithm that I am going to apply is applicable for static objects. The first point I want to do is I want to convert it into a grayscale, because when I go into a grayscale, I have greater confidence in working on, or greater visual ability to working on it. So I will go to other filters, or I can just quickly search gray gray. I get in all the, okay, I misspelled it. Grey is here. It has given me what all is the parameters and everything. I double click this and now it has asked me with various channels. So you have various channels, luminance RGB. We work with R channel and blue channel a lot. Again, I will quickly. I hope we have a good primary RGB in primary secondary colors RGB. So if you see the yellow color is being made, is most visibly being seen in the blue channel. If you have transport vehicle that comes to you as a case, so viewing it in the blue channel is more suggested rather than a red channel. But if you have a regular number plate which has white background, it is a skin or anything, starting with the red channel is fantastic. And then moving out to a variety of, if you want to change the color scheme, cyan, magenta, yellow, clay case, black, you can change that as well. So right now we will use the green one, red one. So it has converted into red. Now I again want to go to filter. And now I want to, if you see, if this was a case that had come to me, I would have come here, Q&A. It would have, one second. So is the footage a video or multiple images? Do you want to enhance the video? Yes, I want to enhance the video. It looks like a compressed video to me. When I looked at it, maybe it looked like a compressed video. Then what do I observe in it? I observed that there is a stationary feature, that is our number plate interest in the part of video. So it has suggested me integrate. So I will double click on integrate and I will use this integrate. As soon as I click on it, I click on the details section. So this is not a dual monitor, hence it is being shown like this. So this is my cockpit where this is our cockpit where we really work out the image enhancement. You have standard, you have manual, you have a lot of things. I do not really remember the offset of it. It is, I believe, 47 and 144. So the major time that we spend is tweaking this offset, tweaking this maximum. There is no one right way in which it is going to work. There is no one click in which you will be able to do the transformation right away. So example, I do it. 147, I don't know this. So if you see, this part is the offset and this is the maximum range that it wants to go. And here you see is the total, right now it is zero. It is the total number of frames that it has integrated. Okay, so now, one second. So now if you see, I'm going to, in the bottom, I'm going to click on play and you will see numbers that keeps on changing here. So if I hit play, if you see, there are so many number of frames per second getting integrated, and that is going to reduce the signal to noise ratio. No rocket science. And now if I zoom it, I don't know if it is very clearly visible. Oh, sorry. So it is something 2, a 5 or a 6. A 0 maybe, a 0 or a O, something like a Y, X or some alphabet here, we don't know. This is something we don't know. So at least, so in a lot of investigations, getting in the right kind of, information, even a single number is very useful. Let us quickly touch base on maybe a misfocus right now. Something that is clearly an example of misfocus. So this is a misfocus example, moving object going in. So since this is a part of our demo images, we have worked on this. So we know what has to be done. Else we will again go through the Q&A section and perform it. If you answer the question rightly, eventually you get suggested the right algorithm. So let me go to the filter section. The other. And so now I understand that there is a few things that I can apply here. I can go to, one second. I can use in a two approach to this. I can use a GPU iterate for this if I had a GPU, or I would use a Wiener for this. Wiener is again a de-blurring filter made by someone, I believe. I don't know the full form of it. So right now, if you see, I have, this is an algorithm which runs for all kind of, de-blurring algorithms. The source of this, you can have a horizontal blur, you can have a vertical blur, you can have a misfocused blur because of lack of the focal distance, general blur, planar. Planar is generally blurred due to motion, if you see on the top of. So any kind of motion blur that we use will use planar. If you do not, this is 1D Gaussian blur is a blur which is used for generally images which have moisture or a fog into it, or a mist kind of a feeling into it. They have a general noise. So sometimes noise filters work on it very well. Sometimes this Gaussian works on this very well as well. So considering now we know that this is a misfocus, again, we know how to tweak this. So let me get into the details of it. Let me select the region. What is my area of interest? And for this particular thing, my blur is somewhere to be 15. Somewhere. 15, and my threshold noise block has to be 0. I don't know what is my noise block, sorry. The noise has to be 0. There is no noise in this. And the threshold, if I increase and play around with the threshold, if you see my visual impact is this, I'm getting the information. I can keep on tweaking it. If I take it this, I'm going to get this. So every time you play around with this, you are either going to get information or either you are going to lose information depending upon the knowledge that the forensic person has, who is the man behind the machine, is more important than the machine. So we believe that. So that is the, this is the time consuming process. To land up to something like, understand that this is going to take 15.2 or a, you know, something like that, it is 7-8 hours, I believe, to understand. So whenever we understand that there is a misfocus, we will use this. In a few cases, there are going to be a planner to be used. Let me see if I have an example for it somewhere. So okay, so I think this is a ready-made image made this particular image has been made by Mr. Ashish Rathod. Mr. Ashish Rathod is the ex-scientific officer from FSL Mumbai, and he really is fantastic in video and audio forensics. If you see the start part of this, the start part of this is something here, very vague. It is near the camera. It might be near the focal length, but this is during the rains, and you really are not able to see what information is. I believe he has made this. So if you see, means it might be not that very well visible here, but yes, mathematically we can, from a very blurry image, we can get some or the other value or pixel information that makes in a lot of sense. So I believe I can go in with a lot of examples. So this is an example used and performed by integration and super resolution. That is a really cool stuff that I forgot to show you in the integration algorithm. That is the displacement, I believe. Displacement of output, 1 second. Other search. If I integrate this example and the displacement is seen in super resolution. I'll remove this. Just to show you the feature of what a pixel displacement looks like. So again, super resolution has multiple techniques. One of them is interpolation. You have nearest neighbor algorithm, you have median algorithm, and you have a reference based algorithm. I personally use a lot of interpolation. So when you look at the interpolation techniques, okay, fantastic. So I've lost the play button. 1 second. I will have to input the video again. But if this particular place, okay, this is a snap, sorry. Apologize for my normal laptop. We are trying to make it behave like a forensic laptop. So, yes. So, example, we will keep it. Itna chota frame lenge. And we select and we perform a super resolution on top of it. Let me then go to technique interpolation and details. So this is a registration point. So now let us look at two things. This is the above screen that I'm playing with the red is to put my area of interest. Where do I want to focus on the number plate? Then comes in my ability to integrate this frames as well first. So when I click on play, you see a lot of displacement parameters that has been calculated at a sub pixel level. So the R, G, B parameters, what is moving where, everything. And this particular calculation, the histogram and the sub pixel displacement allows the Focaler 2, so Impress Pro tool, to really calculate and do super resolution. Post which I can do a super resolution using interpolation technique, and I can click on this. It will take some time. It is a time consuming process and a resource consuming process as well. It might hang. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done that. Let me try closing this, please. Okay, great. So that is the way to have another way to, I mean, this case did not require a super resolution. So using super, it could have easily be done using integration, no super resolution required. But if you do using super resolution also, no harm in that. I believe this is, and all this can be exported snapshot using all the output filters. So I will not deep dive into that. In the interest of time, I will just quickly go back to the tool called as Mandate. Mandate is a tool used for authentication. I will close out this tool. We will all answer the questions at the end of the session for sure, one by one. And my laptop has hanged. Please bear with me. So we generally suggest for video forensics using a machine which has, a graphic accelerator. Using it on laptops and regular just other than another workstation, really means I do not know how to achieve a fantastic performance. When you have a large amount of data or you have a large amount of cases to be processed. So we will go back to the tool from Focaler called as Mandate. Mandate is a tool for understanding images and videos. So okay, great. So this is, I believe we have an update on Mandate as well from Focaler. Since I have been using the tools on a lot of cases since a long time, I have been using the older versions of Impress and Mandate. The newer versions are much more fantastic and they have a few amazing features of image ballistics and other things. So first, in terms of whenever we are importing a particular image or a video, we have open an image, we can open a video. We can also probe a video. In a lot of times, what happens is we do not know what player or what code, not player, what codec has to be used to play a particular video file. So we can use the probe video option, select the video, and it will tell what specific codec is being used. So then we can open in the file with a very specific video engine and then suggest that we want this to be used. Majority of the times what we see is if it is a native file coming in from Hikvision or Dahua, any kind of Chinese brand, it requires to be probed first because there are multiple codec that they use in various set of DVR systems. So the first part we will look as opening a image. For the interest of time, I believe we will keep this image. Okay. In this particular image, what we are able to see is three people, fantastic, and they are not, what do you say, there's no any hindrance or gap in it. So whenever an image comes to us, we first work, we work on major two parameters, the detectors and filters. Let me first get you through the menu, the top of it. Data viewers, this is nothing but what we have in MyFRT or an NKS or any other NUIF, any other tool, visual, hexadecimal, and metadata. Metadata will contain XF information and other informations as well. So again, no rocket science in this. What is very cool about mandate is that they have clones. You generally, whenever we have some or the other operation, we have cloning done in image manipulation. Splicing, in painting, if something has been painted, something has been removed and put, these kind of detection on images can be directly be done. Quickly touching base on the science behind it of what we are trying to achieve. Oh, I believe we are already, it is 1 o'clock and we are short of time. So just a quick thing, let me just print screen. So example, this is a screen and I want to manipulate a particular image. So example, I want to say, I'm sorry, Ms. Shweta Thomas. So example, I want to say ki, this Shweta Thomas ma'am has not attended this session. So what I would do is, I would perform a very simple cloning operation. And I can make this happen. So what I have done in this process is I have created and I have superimposed the exact pixel values, because if I click on this pixel, it has a certain RGB value. I have, copy pasted the exact values here. So that is the kind of feature that mandate is able to identify. So in example, so if I do detectors, clones, and feature-based clones, you have a few parameters, just like Impress Pro, you have a pretty cool mechanism of understanding what is happening in the background mathematically. It takes in a bit of time and you will understand. It is trying to identify various values and correlate that, is there a similar pattern available. So yes, mandate basically, there's a comment, mandate basically detects fake images. So this kind of, there has been something of your removal. This is something we can state. What is the clone detection? What is the parameters? The limitation, as forensic experts, everyone needs to understand that this has a limitation. So what are the alternatives to mandate detect clone? What are the references? What has to be referred? We have a lot of research people here. They can maybe look at it as well. The idea and understanding of this clone detection is detection of features which are parallel. So if you had seen the cloning operation that I did of my name, it was a parallel operation. I did not turn the V upside down. If I want to do that, that kind of operations are challenging to detect. It might require a GPU accelerator. You might have to work on a lower accuracy with higher coverage. So that kind of information will lead to that. Again, authentication of an image, one click, is the image authentic or not? I don't mean, you will have to tweak around it, understand the parameters, how the image is, look it visually. All that mandate is doing is giving you better visual performances. You similarly have splicing in painting, and you have various other filters for your visual ability to understand what is this image about. Some might make sense, some might not make sense. What makes sense should be options and added to the report. Then you can export it in PDF and other formats. We can configure, put your forensic science laboratory logos on top of it and everything. So whenever a case comes to us, we perform detectors. If you are able to find cloning, sorted, the case is solved. Not able to find, go to splicing. Splicing very well can be seen in this particular operation. So you see, that is this bottle of alcohol in which there is some other name that is put, it will get red detected. So any kind of splicing detection can be very well done. So example, now I know cloning is not worked. This is a Photoshop image. So if I do noise analysis on top of it, the noise obviously will always be on the photograph. So then I move on to the next filter, and I will use impainting. So if you see impainting, there has been multiple curves that has been identified in an image. So this is generally, we as close in Photoshop, it is called as feather eraser. So it has been feathered out in a particular way, it has been cut in a particular way such that it blends with the background very efficiently. So if you see big banners or posters, they, if you process that, that will generally have this. And then if we do not get this result by that, we view in the detectors, various kind of, filters that helps us analyze. So example, a zoom test also helps us analyze that there has been a very hard cut here. This can be put into that. There has been no interpolation here. I can have an interpolation and increase the size of this as well. But in a lot of cases, what happens is we are not able to identify by any visual impact. There is zero visual impact that we are able to identify. Then we go into the file type analysis. There are two major file types that are currently being supported, JPEG and PNG. Inside JPEG, you have two things. One is the layout and another one is the quantization tables. Inside layout, what you are able to see is the application segment, the Huffman tables. Means there are forensic scientists and PhD years, and they know better about this than me. When we look at cases or images, we are looking at the application segment, what information is there in application segment, what application was used to work on this particular image. It can be a Canon photo camera, it can be a Photoshop. So we keep on clicking that. So example, now we know this is an edited image. So you can see that in the application segment, there is Photoshop, save for web, quality 60, identified ducky. So this is the information. Again, no rocket science, hexadecimal values represented in a much fantastic way. So that is the way we identify sometimes. Again, we are not able to identify in the application segment as well. Then we go and look at the quantization tables. Inside the quantization tables is nothing but two factors, luminance and chrominance, basic terms, lightness and darkness, or lightness or contrast, that can be said. So if you see, Mandate has a database of a lot of cameras, Photoshop, various application, and a lot of things. So if it is being edited and it is in the database, it is now part of something called as camera ballistics in the new versions. So you can understand. So if you select this Photoshop, you know that this, the luminance and chrominance of the table of the connected file is exactly same as the database entry of that of the Photoshop Adobe. If you example, if it's a cool pad, it is going to be different. Every Nikon D60 has a different pattern. Nikon D70 will have a different. So such kind of patterns have been noted. New mobile phones, new things have been continuously been added. And if this also does not work, we generally contact Folklore and other companies to help us understand what is the next way to go about it. And that is all I believe in terms of images. The most unique part of mandate would be the background processor, the comparer. These are two generally used. Comparer is nothing but creating an interface. This is better viewed at a dual screen. So you will have two particular viewing here. You can apply an algorithm here. You can apply an algorithm here. This says that you want to apply the same filter in both the places. You want to apply different filters. You can utilize this to work and compare cases. You can also utilize it to we remove it, desynchronize. One algorithm is performed here by me, example. Another work of algorithm or another thought process is performed by Ashish or Kumar and anyone from our team in this particular screen as well. So this can have, this has multiple ways how it can be used. The main part that comes in is background processor. I will quickly add the file because it will take some time to process it. I know it is an M. And I want to search for inconsistent motion. I am searching. Okay. This will start working in the in some time once the CPU resources have been allocated. So I can process background in the background. So video takes in a lot of time to process. This is a very small video. In real life, we will not get such a small video. It does not get processed in such a small time. So whenever we input a video here, we select the rendering technique. As you remember, I had shown it earlier. You need to understand the rendering technique. Unless and until you understand what video uses what rendering technique, you cannot process it in the background. So probing of the video is a mandatory step if you want to perform authentication of video. Else you have to understand looking if it's an AVI file format or if you have exported it to from a particular file, you will understand what it is. Then there are four major tasks that can be done on videos using mandate. First is inconsistent motion, which we are going to have a look at right now. And this is to identify, example, there is a theft between 1 o'clock to 2 o'clock, 2 p.m. And I have removed the video of 1 to 2. So there will be some kind of an inconsistently if there are, even if 1 second of frame, 1 second of time duration, a few frames have been removed. Clone frames are things, if example, a person has repeatedly yesterday's 7 a.m. footage, copy pasted today's 7 a.m. footage, you use, you process an entire 30 day of video, you will be able to analyze that 21st ka jo 7 a.m. ka video hai, that is similar, same as that of 22nd ka 7 a.m. video. Frame analysis. If you remember in the presentation, I had touched based on keyframes and a lot of frames. So that is, this allows you to understand how many keyframes and how many other frames are there inside a video. Cross-correlation is again a technique of mandate which utilizes and understands using various parameters if the image is edited or not. So you can utilize in all this. In the interest of time, I'm showing you one thing right now. Open. I hope it doesn't hang. Okay, it's playing. So let me pause it for the while. So this is a video here, okay? Now, after performance of this particular algorithm, so in this left side, always the result has been given, the left for any kind of background processing or any filters that has been applicable. So it has said that frame number 156 has an inconsistent motion. So I will click on frame number 156. It moves me to this direction. So let me just visually see, has it told me the right thing or not? So let me play the video. If there is a network lag, I believe there might be a jerk that you might not be able to see. So if you see, there was a slight jerk in this camera position here. It was here. And next moment it was here. There was this space where it wasn't here, and that has been given. You can go to option, add this to report, export it, and do in a variety of things. I believe I have already overshot my time. And ladies and gentlemen, that's all from my end in terms of what we have been doing and what lab systems in the area of video forensics and analysis is committed to do. Mr. Venkatesan has this vision to transform the space of video forensics and video investigation across India and across the globe. And with that commitment, I thank you enough for this fantastic session to be organized and everyone to have this patience.
Thank you, Vinay. There are so many questions in chat box. I think the moderator will lead to that questions, and you can answer that question. After that, we can go for an open discussion.
Yeah, a question from Hemalata asking, will mandate detect gender change images using face app?
Hemalata ma'am, thank you so much for this question. Ma'am, face gender, I would, that can be done by using Ipsotech. You can identify faces, you can put faces, you can do gender classification, you can identify if a person is having a helmet or not in the entire video span. There's a lot of the things that you can do with AI as such using a tool like Ipsotech inside the forensic lab. Mandate for gender identification in this phase has limited features. It cannot do, to be honest.
There's a question from Mr. Anil. Other than super resolution, can it also enhance audio quality in places where there is CCTV and audio recording?
A very good question. I failed at mentioning that while we take input of audio, there is no processing that is being done on audio, either in Impress Pro or in Mandate at the current stage. In the inputted video, we have a few things to remove the audio or to merge the audio. But in terms of enhancement, the quality and the audibility of the sound, it is not a primary feature of Impress Pro or Mandate. There are many other tools, I believe, which I have been doing. I believe Mr. Ashish from our team is a expert in audio. I learn a lot from him. So, sir, if you have anything, I request you to connect with Mr. Ashish. His email ID is the same as that of mine. Just you have to replace Vinay with the word Ashish. A-S-H-I-S-H.
There's a question from Arvind, sir. Can we identify the source of a doctored and fake videos?
Yes. Using of Mandate, we have found out two limitations that it has. One is it takes in video from a static source. So these are videos coming in from CCTV cameras and a lot of other things. These are not videos coming in from mobile phone cameras, which are moving. When it is moving, it is already inconsistent motion. It cannot have cloned frames. While we perform a lot of things, we will eventually, the results will be negative. The second thing where it shows in, limited ability to perform, or in fact, no ability to perform, is on deep fake images and deep fake videos. So these deep fake and deep fake stuff are made out of something called as convolutional neural networks, CNN. And this is an AI process. One of the most famous thing in this is the face app. A lot of people had used this, changed their age and everything. And a lot of places have cases on top of that. In such a cases, the age progression, identifying the manipulation mathematically is challenging. So means we are competing maths and human intelligence and trying to beat artificial intelligence out of it. I believe the human intelligence has to produce AI-based authentication tool so as to identify these. At this current stage, deepfakes is indeed a challenge.
There's one more question from Hemalata, madam. If a link for a video has to be analyzed, will it be possible to find the location where the video was shot and the date and time of shooting the video?
Okay. Very tricky. In terms of one, because if you upload a video, a lot of streaming websites or in a few unfortunate websites, all the metadata information gets stripped off completely. Example, you send an image via WhatsApp, your EXIF data, where you click the image, what all, is not visible to the other person. That is stripping off the image. The same way it happens to a lot of, in terms of video cases, as whenever a video upload is done. So if the metadata information is not being stripped off, then it is, basically more or less of analyzing, just like you would do with a MyFRT or an NKS or a NUX to analyze the file. It is just metadata information. Begin to understand whether where this photo was, video was shot, where it wasn't. If it's a single video, I believe it is very visual inspection helps us faster than a computer. We understand what kind of trees are in the background, what kind of place it is. So that kind of visual inspection helps us. But using these tools, I believe Impress Pro and Mandate, you will only get in the metadata information. Using Ipsotech, what you can do is you can process in information. Example, if there's a case of terrorism that comes in from the anti-terrorist squad and they find in a few Naxalite videos taken in from highway cameras, and you have that maybe 30 days of footage, practically allocating resource for 30 days to view the video end to end is, I don't think so, it's possible. So in such cases, you can use that video, process it in Impress Pro, perform whether there is gun being detected or not. And that kind of use case can be done. But identifying the location exactly, example, with if the same Naxalite video comes to us and someone and it is just off a road, example, any kind of examples that we have taken on Mandate or Impress Pro in this particular webinar, it is challenging. It is not, it is just visual inspection. Nothing information can be delivered.
Another question from Ms. Mala. What is the limitation on field of area selected in case of enhancement?
It's limitation in terms of field of area.
On field of area selected in case of enhancement.
Okay, so I believe the field of area, the field of view, we are referring to the same terminology. Field of view is a limitation in the investigation process, I believe. Field of view and blind spot. In terms of forensic process, if it is not in the field of view, you will not be able to see it. And if it is, we have spoken about the impact of focal length, I believe, while enhancement as well. So that still holds true.
There's another question from Harsh. Can brain mapping be used to verify testimony on authenticity of video evidence?
Oh, Harsh, fantastic thought process. Thank you so much. I believe you can see my email ID on the screen. I think this should be taken offline. I really want to, we use brain mapping a lot, but how do we use brain maps for enhancement? I'm more than willing to learn from you.
Another question, can we detect the tampering of an audio which is incorporated into a video by analyzing metadata of a file?
Authenticity of an audio which is incorporated in a video. Okay, which is already there. Authenticity already there. Then again, like I mentioned, we can, the process of this generally would be to forensically extract the audio out of the mandate system. Like I mentioned earlier, Ashish uses a lot of tools like Batwalls. There's a lot of multi-speech and tools which have been used very efficiently since ages, and that works out very fine. How much time it takes to analyze those audios? That I believe audio experts always debate upon.
So one more question from Shijin. Any open source tool for the video enhancement?
Shijin sir, namaste. Good to have, I glad to know that you are here. And open source, there's we can use in any kind of, let us try to understand, we are going, means we could have done all this on Photoshop for images. We could have done all this on something like a Final Cut Pro or Adobe Premiere Pro, the video editing softwares. We could have done that. Open source currently, I am not aware of. I get to use all these fantastic tools, so I have not unfortunately bothered myself to look out for that.
Is there any other questions?
So one more question. Up to how many pixel value of any image or video can be enhanced? Question was from Ankit.
Hi Ankit, thank you for the question. So see, we can keep on. If you had seen the, this is a good question, and this requires some kind of information sharing. Interpolation. I have not shared. So if you see, Ankit, I'm sorry, I forgot your name. Original is on the left side. I have enlarged it once, 183%, and I have made the calculation. Understand that the calculation will have a limitation. It is making a prediction ki agar yahan pe red color hai and yahan pe blue color hai, to yahan pe shayad green color hoga. So it is making that prediction. I can enlarge it once by 183%. I can enlarge it again 300%. But every single time from the original, the optically captured image, I am mathematically transforming it. With each and every interpolation that comes in, there will be an error factor which gets added to the entire image. We will if we look at this level of pixel, we will be able to understand, but generally we don't. But you can keep on enhancing and enlarging it to XYZ level. If you have a high resolution image to be expanded to a 4K level of image, in that kind of a scenario, you might require a hardware processor and a lot of other things to support you. But you can go in a lot. How much visually appealing it will be, that is debatable.
That's all, sir. I request Sanoj, sir, to kindly conclude this.
Okay, there are some offices from FSL. Other FSLs like Delhi FSL, I request them to kindly comment on this presentation. I invite them to kindly speak few words about Vinay, and it will be a good appreciation to him.
Am I audible? This is Ms.
Yeah, Hale. Yes.
From Deputy Director Forensic Sciences Department, Chennai. As usual, Vinay is always very agile and very informative in his presentation. So today also he has presented. I've listened to his presentation twice before. So today also, this is the first webinar I am listening to what Vinay is speaking. But it is very informative. He was telling about mandate. He has actually explained what are the capabilities of the software, as well as he has also explained about its limitation, which is very welcoming in nature. So mandate has got certain capabilities, whereas other softwares has got certain capabilities. He has explained both together and made the session very useful to each one who has participated in this webinar. That is my observation.
Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else? I think no one wants to comment on this. So if there are any other questions, you can go ask him and we can before going to point.
Sir, myself, Narasimhan, Assistant Director from FSL Delhi.
Welcome, sir.
Hi, sir. I want to ask one question. Is it possible to find the desynchronizing between the audio and video? Sometimes they are investigation agency want to know about that. Is it both the audio and video is synchronized or not? Is it possible to find out? Please.
Lakshmi sir, thank you so much for the question. No, at this current stage, sir, we are ourselves trying to figure this out. It is an important use case using the current tools, Mandate and Impress Pro. Desynchronization of audio and video is not possible. But having said that, this is, I believe, July, somewhere in August or September, we will have this feature. It is a request which we have made it to the Folklore. It is in their development cycle.
Okay. Is it any tool in this? Excuse me. In one more question, please. Is it the tool in this tool? Is it available to find the authenticity of the video automatically?
Yes, sir. That is what we are trying to do with four major algorithms. So, in a real life situation, you will not have one case. You will for sure. I don't know FSL deals with single and they already workload is too much. So, in such cases, the tool is very efficient to take in multiple videos. On each video, you can perform 404 authentication algorithms, all and the report can automatically be generated.
Okay, thank you. Okay,
thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lakshmi.
Sir, anyone else?
Sir, please ask him whether he can give the authenticity of the camera, the recording device signature is available somewhere while recording.
Yes, sir.
Sir, hello, Mr. Vinay. How are you? This is.
I'm doing good, sir. How are you, sir? Pleasure talking to you after a very long time, sir.
Sir, I'm really just now. I got a couple of minutes back. I got your link, and I'm extremely glad to hear. Acha, you please tell me one thing.
Yes, sir.
I want to know whether the signature of the recording device is available somewhere.
Yes, sir. So let me again represent the screen. So the thing that we talked about camera ballast, the thing that we were seeing for images, the same thing can be done for gay as well. What do you say? Videos as well. It comes under the camera ballistic section in the new version.
Yes, exactly. That's what I am interested. Number one and number two, if you allow for a couple of 60 seconds to me, see in DVR, when we remove the hard disk, whether the only DVR will allow us to give information. Is it available?
Sorry, sir. There was a ring in the background. I missed your last statement, sir.
Can you please repeat that question?
I'm repeating. I suppose if we are having a DVR and we have removed the hard disk right now, because sometimes if you get only the DVR without hard disk, then what information that we can generate from there? Signature of DVR?
Sir, one second, sir. Sir, we generally recommend using of something like a DVR examiner.
No, that I'm, and we are all working on that. See, that's great. But just I wanted to know that any signature that is available over there, because if we have to answer beyond that, beyond our examiner, anything, okay, then we can discuss through mail perhaps better.
Sure. Sir, just to quickly understand, first is, sir, mandate has an option to probe. So if you understand that it was a Hikvision codec that was used or Dahua codec that was used,
you can clearly identify
which was the recording device. In terms of camera, there are two things to that, sir. One is the DVR in which the file is being stored. Example, it is a video file, which can be identified by probing. So if I just have got a hard disk and I connect it and to a DVR examiner, I perform present file, deleted file recovery. I take the present file and I do a probe video on top of this.
Exactly.
Once I do a probe video, I will get an understanding of what file system is used. Similarly, in moving forward in the next version, here instead of file type, there is something called as camera ballistics.
Exactly. I'm interested to it, sir. Yes.
So we do in a lot of cases around India, around the globe, I believe, right now, with the kind of exposure.
I personally know that. I know that.
So we are facing with n number of issues, and the more we interact with the warriors in the forensic science laboratories. I call them warriors because the cases are always more, and people and tools are always less. So
I'm really thankful to aapka lecture. Mujhe bahut acha laga. Kafi dino ke baad. After long, I heard that, and acha, it's good, quite informative. Yes.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
To me, to ourselves also. Thank you.
Mr. Vinay, I have a small question. Is it post?
Sir.
Vinay.
Yes.
I have a small question. Is it possible in Ipsotech we can integrate whether the video visuals from different DVR examiners? Means different video DVR systems, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So,
you are showing some tracking system. So, consider a case we have two different DVR systems. Is it possible to integrate those videos in a single case?
Different.
So let us try to get the use case. So first is to have a premises one where there has been a theft, premises two where there has been a theft, and we are trying to correlate if the person is the same theft or there is a common vehicle or something of that sort. Correct? This would be a general overview of it. So in such cases, what again would be the workflow is you will have hard disk one of the DVR system coming in. You will perform one to two replica inside your lab. You will that one will go into the kept as a copy, another is a working copy. That working copy E01 file which has been stored will get converted into video file, various video files, which then would be inputted inside Ipsotech. Ipsotech will not sit on top of the DVR because it will then be also manipulation of it, to be honest. We cannot directly work on top of the DVR. So Ipsotech will always work with files. So example, now DVR 1, crime scene 1, 30 days of video, 3000 files. Crime scene 2, 30 days of video, 400 files. So if this 700 files together can be inputted inside Ipsotech, and you can perform facial recognition, object recognition, number plate recognition, and all such algorithms on top of it.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other questions? Let me wind up the session. Anyway, thank you, Vinay, for a fantastic or a very informative talk on video enhancement. You have touched the fundamentals of video capturing and all things. And it will be very useful for every investigating officers and forensic experts and all things. And one more thing I wish to add is working with a single software, it is not complete. So we have to use many softwares to complete the investigation and analysis purpose. Anyway, thank you, Vinay, for a fantastic and a wonderful session. And I will hand over I take this opportunity to thank all participants that you have all participants participated in this webinar. And I thank you very much for ICFSA for conducting such a wonderful talk and webinar, and handovering this session to the moderator to wind up the session.
Thank you so much, sir. I thank Mr. Vinay for this wonderful session, and I also thank Shri Sanmukh sir for presiding over this session and all the participants who were a part of this. Thank you all once again. Hope you all have a wonderful evening.
Thank you so much for the organizers who organized the webinar. So I thank ICFSA for organizing such a useful webinar to all the forensic fraternity.
Thank you all, and keep in touch with Google or Google Meet so we can discuss at any time, anywhere. Thank you.
And for all the forensic experts out there, Lab Systems and Vinay Vishwanath are already always available for any kind of case help. Please be assured of it. If there is anything, we are more than willing to help. Thank you so much.
Vinay, I would like to contact you personally. Definitely, I will call you. I will collect the number from the Shivaprasad, and I just want to talk to you. Personally,
sure,
okay.
Sir.
Thank you, Vinay.
Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you.
And thank you, Vinay, for the wonderful session, and Sanosa, moderator Sweta, and other eminent participants from officers from CFSL and other police officers. Thank you for being with us and joining with ICFSL. We will be seeing in the next webinar. Thank you, Vinay, and the Lab System team.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And one person to be, I forgot to thank. You know,